Previously on The Adventure Zone. Your decision, trust their decision, and in bright red letters, the word forsake appears.
Son of a...
One of these giant pieces of, like a washing machine size piece of industrial machinery, falls from the ring on the ceiling and lands on you.
You're gonna kill America's favorite wizard.
You see a severed human head, and then its eyes open, and it goes, blah!
Magnus does not react.
My name's Cam. Sorry I can't greet you with a formal handshake, but I seem to have misplaced my everything. But somehow the two liches that run this place are empowering themselves not with their own emotion, but with the emotions of people who came into Wonderland, specifically suffering.
I don't think our boys are having much fun playing the suffering game. Maybe their luck will improve in round two. But probably not. It's the Adventure Zone.
Do you Dungeons and Dragons?
I wish we could have somebody on the call who made the game that can be like, oh, it's been a month and a half.
Show me how to Dungeons and how to Dragons.
Teach me how to Dungeons.
You can't just do one of them.
I've got these dice in front of me. Is okay. That part of it?
You think we just roll those and like dragons come out of them? Damn.
No.
Hold on.
There's that popper ball in the middle, and we push down on
it. It's a pop-o-matic situation.
Yeah. Pop-o-matic.
That's why they call it D&D, Dice and Dragons.
Yeah.
Let's get back into it. You guys
My daughter calls them dreidels.
She does.
That's simply inaccurate.
Dreidels.
That's a thing already. So you boys are in a bit of a pickle after the last round of Wonderland. It didn't go so great. I mean, you won. You're alive. Whatever. You've got a new head friend that lives in Travis's backpack, I guess.
What was
Cam.
His name?
Cam.
Dad gets the memory award, which is the first time. Pin that on his vest, so congrats. And you are back in the Wonder Wheel room. And the theme song to that is, of course, a fun parody of the song Wonderwall by Oasis that I've written, and I'll sing for you right now.
Okay.
So let's go ahead and get moving. You are back.
This time was going to be a time when you and I were going to get it straight. We were going to do our best together, but now we're not going to get it together. Wonderwall. This isn't how parodies work.
No.
It's also not
the music and words were different, and you didn't even say Wonder Wheel.
It's a thematic reimagining.
Oh, I thought we were doing the Fred Savage thing.
It's a meditation on Wonderwall.
Wonderwall deconstructed.
This is not your daddy's Wonderwall.
You guys like Westworld, right? Just like Westworld.
More or less. So you're back in the wheel room, and if you will remember, the elves sensed a fourth presence in the room, and so there are four lights above the door across this big circular room. It's about the same shape and size as all of the other rooms that you've been in since you've been in Wonderland. And you have the wheel in the middle, and it's time to roll your ball. There's no ball. Spin the wheel.
Just a reminder to though, because it has been 6 years since we played. What happens if we refuse to do whatever comes up on the wheel?
A penalty.
Okay.
That's all you know.
Could you be more vague?
I don't know, Chandler. I love him.
Got him.
Love that.
I love his humor.
Very 90s show.
Super South Park humor. Very random. Who's going first? And also, somebody's going to have to go two times.
I'll go.
I think I have the most hit points.
Okay, fine. Believe it or not. Fuck it. You go.
I'll go twice.
Oh, wow.
To Big spin bold. The wheel of torture.
Hey, Merle, I just want to say I really appreciate you taking the hit and doing both times.
Just click the button. Thank you.
All right.
You just click the button.
It means a lot to me that you would step up and do that. Thank you so much.
While you're saying he's literally can't figure out how to spin the wheel. He's like grabbing it by the spokes and like moving it one direction, but then like twisting it back the other direction. And he's just having some trouble clicking the image on the website.
Yeah, you just spin it, buddy. Come on.
Yeah, I did. I mean, I did. I got the same thing. I.
Oh, shit. Let me do a judgment call with Justin and Travis real quick. Sidebar. Is it more interesting if we do other stuff, or should I just really just keep blasting Dad's eyes?
Let's just go with the eye, I guess.
Yeah, go with the eye, my man.
Let me guess. I'm colorblind.
You hear the male elf say, no, it's going to be a bit more severe than that. Usually we don't have so many repeat landings like that, so I feel really sorry for your peepers.
Wait, that one was for Cam. He's got eyes.
Or should I? Well, who? For who?
For the fourth presence that you have detected. This isn't like a surprise. Come on, you know about him.
Nah, take the lumps. Give me the lumps. Bring it. See, give me your best shot.
Also, the
son of a lich.
The arrangement that you made with Cam was that you would take his sacrifices because he doesn't have anything else to sacrifice, really.
I mean, he's got eyes.
He's got eyes, though.
You hear Cam. You can hear Cam from your bag say, like, well, that wasn't our arrangement. You said you would take my lumps for me.
All right, shut
I'm
up, Jobby.
I'm taking the lumps. Give it to me.
All right. Unfortunately, this is going to be a pretty tough game for your peepers, it sounds like, Merle. Or should I say your peeper? Because the penalty for this round landing on eye is one of them.
What?
It's not going to be grisly or anything like that. We're not going to send in a flock of birds to come, you know, peck it out or anything. And you hear the other elf, the female elf say, yeah, we don't really roll that grizzly anymore. It gets a little too intense too fast. It's just gonna not be there.
Huh. Can I have like a cool Odin patch thing?
That's a fair trade-off. We could hook you up with a sick-looking eye patch. I think we have something like that in our closet.
Do I get to choose which eye?
I think that's only fair.
Do I have a third eye? You know, like a whole mystical.
No, but you do have a third nipple. But that's
but
not
that. That's nothing. Not germane.
That ain't on the table.
That's off the table.
You can't see through it, and you can't say no.
Which arm is the tree arm?
Your non-dominant arm. Or no. I'm sorry. Your dominant arm. Remember, because you reached out and grabbed it with your dominant arm, and
right.
The bracer's on your non-dominant arm, and you still have your bracer. So I'm gonna guess your right arm, right? Because you're right-handed, or are you a southpaw?
No, right arm.
Okay.
Take my left eye.
Whoa.
Okay. As soon as you say that, Merle, your depth perception just like shifts, and it's fucking weird.
Or is it like that, Griff, or is it like he closed one eye?
I mean, it's like that, but
it's
also
like the world is spinning around him. He just closed an eye.
Everything's 2D.
It's not, but I mean, it's like gone. Like that eye is that your left eye is now gone. It's just skin kind of there now. But a white ball in front of you appears, and an eye patch is sort of floating in the middle of that ball. And you hear the female elf say, normally we don't sort of give prizes out like this, but I just think you'll be sort of more pleasant to look at if you're wearing this.
And draw.
And what are the magic properties of this eye patch?
You don't, there are no magic properties to the eye patch. For your, if you make any ranged attack rolls though, you are going to take a -2 penalty to those
magic
from now on. But if you make intimidation rolls because you have this sort of more haggard appearance now, you get a +2 to those. So mark that down. And I'm also going to leave it. What does this eye patch look like? I don't want to decide this sort of like character trait for you.
I want it to look like Scorpius on Far Reach.
What are you?
You'd fucking
no, I don't know what you're talking about.
One, Farscape, and two, sick Farscape. Pull. That's a great pull, Dad. Big fan. Seen every episode.
Yeah. Okay, he doesn't have... Okay, this dude's not wearing an eye patch. He's wearing, like, a fucking, like, jock strap on his fucking face, and that cannot be your steez. I refuse to let this be your steez. This man is not wearing an eye patch. He's wearing a facial thong, and it's not pleasant to see.
All right, here's the deal. It is, like, in the shape of Superman's emblem on his chest, and the cord, instead of going straight around... goes from the corner and above my nose.
Okay.
It goes around and connects with the bottom. It's not around the head. It's
so it's sort of a diamond shaped crest. And what's on it? Because I don't think the Superman logo should be it. Because that's now we're getting to trademark territories.
An owl.
All right, sort of a badass owl.
Kind of a stylized looking owl.
I fucking feel it. Cool. Yeah, that was your animal for the race, right?
Right, and why potato chips have a winking owl? So I don't know what that means.
Potato chips is why you made the decision. Taco and Merle, do you guys want to go next?
Hey, Merle, yeah. I just want to say that's a sick looking eye patch, my man.
I know, right?
I will go next.
Okay, Magnus, you step up to the wheel.
I got clock.
Clock. Oh man, you hear the voice of the female elf, and she says, This one is kind of a tough pill for most participants to swallow, because what you're going to have to sacrifice is time, Magnus. And as a human, unfortunately, that's in somewhat short supply for you. For this round of the wheel, we're going to need 10 years.
Huh.
If you choose this and you go through with it, Magnus will instantly age 10 years.
I mean, this doesn't really bother me.
How old is Magnus? And don't try to say, like, you're 12.
No. I was thinking, like, early 30s. Like,
all right.
Like, 32, 33. I mean, my age.
All right.
How I've been picturing him.
Why don't you give him your elementary school and middle school days? That would be about 10
years. That's not how that works.
That ain't how it works.
No.
I was born 10.
I mean, honestly, here's the thing. Are we assuming, like, that I would have lived this 10 years? Like, that this 10 years is, like, just you replace...
That is a fucking great point. Magnus do rush in, so the chances of him making it to 42, this might be a pleasant surprise for him.
So, like...
Oh, look at me!
If we assume that 10 years, I've totally kept up my physique and stayed healthy, yeah, 42, 43, fine. Yeah, fuck it. Whatever. Doesn't bother me.
All right.
I'm way past the young man days where I care about suddenly being 32 instead of 22. Fuck it. 42, 32, who cares?
As he's, like, saying this, as Magnus is talking about, like, as he's rationalizing this, Merle and Taco, you see, like, his sideburns start getting these little, like, gray hairs. What color hair does Magnus have? Like, brownish?
I don't know. Yeah, brownish, auburn, whatever.
Well, now it's, like... It's starting to grow, like, pretty gray pretty fast. And it's not, like, you're not full-blown silver fox right now, but there is a lot of silver poking through the auburn.
Tell me about my laugh lines, Griffin.
I mean, you're also...
my crow's feet?
Your eyes are the only things that are getting, like, especially wrinkled. Because, you know, Magnus has been through some shit. How do you have any other sort of suggestions for how this would sort of change Magnus?
Well, so this is my question. Is it like we are replacing 32-year, like, in the timeline with a 42? Because then I'd probably have a couple, like, facial scars, a couple Harrison Ford.
No, it wouldn't be like that. Mix. It's just like your body just goes through, just ages 10 years in a second. Very like Last Crusade style.
I see. I would say the muscles probably become a little bit leaner and sinewier rather than bulky.
Okay. And
my pubes go totally gray.
Oh, no, that's no good.
No, trust me.
But my butt.
George, come on. I'm in hell.
I'm dead in hell.
Now.
I'm in hell. I'm shutting
you. You open the door. You built the fucking door out of wood. Shit wood. Shame on you and shame on us.
I started it.
I appreciate it.
I will take any penalty. I'll just let me spin. Travis is old now.
Magnus, there's no mechanical penalty for this, but you do feel like. I mean, dude, you feel like a fucking bus just hit you. You just aged 10 years and, like, your body, it's like your body is different and you don't know how to, like, deal with it, I guess. So yeah, Magnus is now 42 years old. And Taco?
Yeah.
You hear the male elf say, "I gotta say, you guys are really taking this in stride." Because you have not emitted any of that bad stuff up into the air.
You know, I'm just happy to be here.
Just make the best of a bad situation. Okay, I got body.
Oh, fucking shit. Okay. All right. You hear the male elf say, "I have to say, body is not our most elegant selection on the wheel. But all we're going to do for body is sort of take away some of your vitality, some of your living essence, if that makes sense. We're not going to hurt you, Taco, because I don't honestly think we can do that much more without you being dead, and, well, that's no fun. But we are going to make you less alive. If you choose this, Taco, you are going to have 15 subtracted from your max HP.
Oof.
Okay.
Okay.
Good, yeah.
Just like that, while you... as soon as you say that, you feel yourself kind of like dry up a little bit. Like you get like a dry mouth all of a sudden and your stomach feels kind of sour.
No, this is a good question. Griffin, how does it translate to like real life? Does he have 15% less blood or like, what does that mean?
I mean, it's a very calculated thing on my part because like the very worst case scenario is, okay, take all the hit points you want. Worst case scenario is Taco dies and I get my Tuesday afternoons back. Like, do I have to? I mean, I have to listen to Dad recording with you chuckle fucks like next to me while I'm doing cool shit. That's way better than this, but I think it's a fucking good trade off.
Okay, so subtract 15 from your max HP.
I did it already. Like, you can't affect me. You can't hurt me. It's done. It's already done. What's next? I'll take the other one. Give me stupids.
No. You hear the two elves talking now, and they're like, "I don't know. Maybe we should go harder on them. They don't seem to be that upset about all this."
Come on, do it.
Are you going to?
We're
take
having
the next...
a great time. It's real fun. I like the challenge. You know,
this is good.
Thank you so much for this.
And they haven't had as good a job prospect as Taco in a long time. Maybe they'll back off of him.
So Taco, are you really taking the next role?
No.
Okay, we're gonna fight over who gets.
I'm still Spartacus. The most hit points.
That's fine. Okay, yeah.
Give me the wheel.
All right, Merle, you go in for a roll. Before we get to that...
Stop it. Stop playing with the mouse.
What is going on?
Dad was moving the mouse while I was using the trackpad. It was all very confusing.
while Taco was taking his turn and while Merle is taking his turn, Magnus, you feel something. And it almost feels like something...
It's incontinence. Surprise.
No, you feel something poke the palm of your hand. And as you like reflexively kind of like pull your hand away, you feel it again, only some sort of force is like pressing down into your hand and moving in sort of deliberate strokes. What do you do?
Get a boner.
Like it's making shapes on my hand?
Yeah, like it's like tracing something in your hand.
Is it letters?
So if you don't like if you sit there and you try to like figure out what this thing is doing, are you like panicking? Are you like saying
no? Anything? Now in my old age, I've grown a lot calmer.
Okay,
and I just sit there and calmly experience this sensation. I'm practicing mindfulness now in my 40s.
Okay, you sit here and you just try to like you focus on the shapes without like panicking or making a big scene about it, and you feel this same pattern over and over again, more and more forcefully being pushed into your hand. And after like a dozen or so repetitions, you realize something is familiar about the pattern, because it's something that you've been studying very recently back at the headquarters with Carrie. This force is making the shape of Thieves' Cant into your hand, which is the secret written language of symbols that thieves use to sort of communicate with each other. And right now it's making two shapes in your hand. And the first one is a shape that means silence, which sort of like warns potential burglars of nearby listening marks. And then the next shape is confirm, which thieves use to sort of ensure that other thieves have seen their message. So it's saying silence and then asking you to confirm.
Okay, with my left hand.
Yeah.
I start just kind of without looking at my hand or drawing attention to it, just moving my finger in the shape of confirm.
Okay. It makes another set of symbols, and it says secret, which thieves use to sort of like, well, I mean, it's a very thief-like symbol that they are trying to remain, you know, incognito.
We know what secrets are, Griffin. Thank you so much for
and then
this.
And then it marks confirm a second time. So it's saying, you know, secret, confirm.
I make the shape.
Okay, and you're having like this secret thieves can't conversation with this unseen force, and it goes through a few symbols. It does one, the number one. That's not really a thieves can't symbol. That's just like one, and then the shape for room. So it says one room, and then a symbol that lets you know that like magic forces are afoot, and then the symbol for room again, and then the symbol for transformation. So it's telling you magic room transformation. And then it sends one last message to you. And the first one is a symbol that thieves use to sort of let each other know that they should wait for some sort of signal before they proceed with whatever job they're about to do. And then confirm. So wait for signal, confirm.
I confirm.
Okay. Merle. Let's spin that wheel.
Chance?
Oh, this is good. Okay. I was hoping this might show up this round. You hear the female elf say, chance is kind of a tricky one, and it sort of measures your judgment as a participant here in Wonderland. All you have to do for chance is lay something down on the wheel, and it can be physical or not physical, and it can be more than one item if you wish. That you think is a sufficient sacrifice on par with the other things that have been sacrificed this round. And if you are correct and you do give a sufficient sacrifice, then you get to move on and it counts as a point. But if you do not give up enough, then you lose the items that you put forward and it doesn't count and you have to go again and keep on giving and giving until you have satisfied the chance. So you can sacrifice anything, physical, metaphysical, whatever that you think is equivalent to like the value of the things that have also been sacrificed this round, and if you like pass the bar, then you get to move on. Otherwise, you still lose the things and still have to go again until you have given up enough. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
So it's kind of a roll of the dice. If you give something shitty, you'll lose the shitty thing and it won't count and you'll still have to do it.
What or do you have that's worth 10 years?
Well, I've had my trusty Warhammer since I was just a little sprout, so that's over 50 years.
You cannot retcon a story into an item. My dad's
it's
dad
my
gave
Warhammer.
Me this thing, and it's really great, and I really love. Did I tell you how to name for it this whole time? I've really loved.
He does have a name for it. It's a little smusher.
Fair enough.
All right.
I just don't want you to lose your Warhammer and something else. I'm trying to look out for you.
I would say putting down one of your main weapons is pretty.
Well, you also have the arc light. You also have the arc light spanner,
and he hasn't hit anything for roughly 30 hours.
This is true. You also have spells that make angels appear, so you can probably sacrifice a couple of weapons.
I know what you should put in there. The Bible.
Oh my gosh.
That's the book for me. I stand alone on the word of Pan, the B-I-B-L-E, Bible.
Now, I will say that is your holy symbol. If you get rid of that, then you cannot use your holy magics. Although they've been pretty faulty lately, so.
So maybe not that.
Although I dig the symbolism there. I'm just warning you, if you do that, you will not be able to cast spells.
Well, that's no good. I mean, it's not like he's been a real spell factory thus far, but you know what? I can't keep penalizing Dad for these actions.
I will lay down on this, whatchamacallit?
It's a wheel.
The wheel. My adamant spanner.
What, the spanner?
Which has been which has been the only thing that has worked for me for the last 4 or 5 arcs. I've had it since Pedals to the Metal. I have posed for a lot of pictures with it. I'll give it my adamant spanner.
Okay, and that's it.
And
so think you can think outside the box. I mean, that might be enough. I don't know. But it's not just physical items. It can be memories. It can be you could sacrifice a language that you speak. Like literally, you could sacrifice anything to add to the value.
You know, I've had my wedding ring on a chain around my neck this whole time.
It's always been super important to
Well, him. If you really look at some of the art that, you know, you can see a faint outline in my armor.
Mm-hmm.
And okay. It's the symbol.
Okay.
It's the symbol. I'll put my wedding ring.
That you've had the whole time. I just wanted to clarify. That I had the whole time.
Isn't Merle divorced?
Yeah, and Merle, really you ran out on your family. You are a deadbeat.
Well, yeah.
I'm confused about the symbolism you're giving up here, Merle.
I am giving up the sense of loss of losing my family.
Wait, you ran out on them. You can't give up bad emotions.
I'm giving up the guilt I feel at the shitty thing I did.
These liches feed on negative emotions.
You're turning this into a fucking Oprah special. Like, you can't let go. It's an Oprah special that's like beating myself up for bad choices.
I'm a shithead. Feel bad for me. The Oprah special. You get a car.
All right, funny guys.
Yeah.
I give up my wood arm.
Oh, no. Whoa, Clinton.
No, you've got live appearances to think about.
Oh yeah. I'll give up the adamant spanner. This bundle of rope.
This is like the end of the jerk.
This wedding ring that was my only happy memories from when my little family was still intact.
Mm.
Before someone ripped it
before
apart.
Someone did a bad thing.
Yeah.
I want, like, the guy from Amazing Discoveries in his dumbass sweater to be standing at a pedestal like, that's not enough. You know how we do it on Amazing Discoveries anymore. Throw in a chamois.
And my battle axe.
You could give up 5 years of your life because, like, you're already, what's the difference? You know what I mean?
I give up my adamant spanner.
The wedding ring.
The wedding ring and my battle axe.
Does that leave you with
your
any
hand
weapons?
Axe? You have a hand axe. I'm almost certain you don't have a battle axe. I can't believe how many times we've had this argument. But you can sacrifice the hand axe, sure.
Okay, it says battle axe, hand axe. No. Those are just proficiencies. Those aren't items that you have. You could give up your battle axe proficiency. As long as you're giving up the battle axe.
Yeah. I will give up the battle axe.
Hey, can I give up my proficiency with bows?
The battle axe proficiency.
My bow staff proficiency.
That's gotta be enough now, okay. Right?
My nunchuck.
And my wedding ring.
My nunchuck proficiency.
All right. Which is worth, by the way, the wedding ring's worth about 5,000 gold.
This whole time.
This whole time.
Cannot stress enough. This has been so true the whole time. Griffin
also would like to apologize for editing out Dad's frequent and blatant references to the wedding ring that has been on his neck.
Yeah, sorry, guys.
And I'll agree to be colorblind.
Okay.
No, I'm holding on to color. Okay.
Okay, so to summarize, the adamant spanner, the wedding ring, your battle axe proficiency, and that's what you're doing? Okay. Right? Yes? Confirm?
And?
Oh, my God.
No, I think you've given enough.
Or have.
I don't think I have.
That and was in universe. That was one of the male elves says, and that's it, huh? That's all you're going to give up?
See.
And this, like, clearly just fucking with you.
Oh, he's fucking with you, Dad. Don't let him push you around.
If that's all you want to give up, that's fine. That might be enough.
Final answer.
All right. You lay down your axe and wedding ring on the wheel, and they both... Or no, sorry. The adamant spanner and the wedding ring, you lay them down on the wheel, and they both kind of sink in. And then you you sort of like fade to white, and you remember being in the wooded enclave that you and your druidic pan worshipping family lived in, this sort of commune that you lived in as a child, and you're maybe a teen or something like that, and one of the members of the enclave was attacked by a bear and just barely survived, and it sent a real scare through the community and sort of made you sort of struggle with your own mortality, and so you went to a woodsman in the woods who is not a part of the enclave, and he taught you how to wield an axe to protect yourself, and you trained with him for years and years, and he was sort of one of the first sort of figures that sort of showed you what life was like outside of this sheltered enclave, while you're thinking of this, you are having a hard time remembering what his face looked like, and then you can't remember anything about him, and then you don't remember any of that part of your life at all, and it's just gone.
I really hate this arc. I just wanted to pass along to you, Griffin.
Hey, everybody, this is Griffin McElroy, your Dungeon Master, your best friend, and your ice skating trainer. I want to see you tighten up that axle. Thanks for listening to episode 54 of The Adventure Zone. I believe it's the fourth episode in this Suffering Game arc, which I hope is living up to the title. I want to tell you all about a few sponsors this week. First off, I want to tell you about Blue Apron. Blue Apron is wonderful. I have used it for a very long time. I've gotten much, much better at cooking because of Blue Apron. What they do is for less than $10 per person per meal, Blue Apron delivers seasonal recipes along with pre-portioned ingredients to make delicious home-cooked meals. There are so many good meals on the roster that you will learn how to cook and you'll do a great job and it'll taste really good. I'm talking about stuff like seared pork chops with farro and cranberry chutney, spaghetti squash and marinara with mushrooms and garlic knots, spicy shrimp and Korean rice cakes with cabbage and furikake. I'm just going to say that word much more confidently from now on. Furikake. It's all super, super great. I'm a huge fan of Blue Apron, and you can check out this week's menu and get your first three meals for free with free shipping by going to blueapron.com/adventure. That's blueapron.com/adventure. Blue Apron, a better way to cook. I'm hoping you're still hungry because I also want to tell you about Nature Box. I've been snacking a lot on Nature Box recently. I have a newborn baby that like keeps me up from like 3 to 5 every a.m., and during that time, all I want to do is nosh on some snacks. My personal favorites are stuff like the salt and pepper pop pops. I got some Big Island pineapple that I'm a big fan of. They've got raspberry whole wheat figgy bars. Love those. Been snacking on those like crazy. They taste great and they're better for you. They're created with high quality ingredients that are free from artificial colors, flavors, or sweeteners, so you can feel great about snacking again and you don't have to worry about, you know, going to the store and looking at every single label on every item on the shelf because you just know that it's going to be good. And right now, you can save even more. NatureBox is offering Adventure Zone fans 50% off your first order when you go to naturebox.com/adventure. That's naturebox.com/adventure for 50% off your first order. One more time, that is naturebox.com/adventure. Got a few Jumbotron messages here for you. Thank you to everybody who bought a Jumbotron spot in 2017. I'm pretty sure we are sold out of spots for the entire year, which is amazing. Thank you all for supporting us so much. I want to tell you to visit justapuzzlegame.com. Just a Puzzle Game is a fun and challenging mobile game. It was definitely not created by an evil mega corporation to reverse engineer an experimental AI that went rogue. It's not that. Solving the more than 1,000 unique levels will not reveal cryptic hidden messages, tantalizing clues, or mysterious ciphers. You won't learn a terrifying secret. It's just a puzzle game. Go to justapuzzlegame.com to learn more. I'm pretty sure I just violated like 12 FCC things because I think this is one of those goof-em-ups where all those things are true. I got a message here for Cal, and it's from Julia, who says, "Happy 21st birthday. Here's a shout-out for the best Pathfinder playmate ever to thank you for all the campaigns." Oh, nope. Did a wrong emphasis there. "Here's a shout-out for the best Pathfinder playmate ever to thank you for all the campaigns you've invited me to and all the characters you've min-maxed with your damn cheater skills. You're the greatest friend ever, and I hope to adventure with you for many years to come, in-game and out. You're the best, and I love you this much." And this is in all caps. So that's like the only sort of metric. Like all the letters are super duper big. So that is how much Julia loves you, Cal. So that is very, very special. This message was also supposed to go up in July. That was half a year ago. Oopsa-doopsa. I want to thank everybody who's been tweeting about the show using the ZoneCast hashtag. If you use that hashtag, you might end up as a character in the show. And I'm talking about characters like Cam, who's named for Cam Marshall, at SplarfLord on Twitter. I'm also talking about, and these names are about to be revealed, Lydia, Hacked Motion Art on Twitter, and Edward, Lumberbuns on Twitter. You could end up as a character on the show. Now, we are kind of getting down to the end of it, but there will definitely be a chance for more character names to end up in the show, so get in your tweets with the ZoneCast hashtag. Also, just like personally speaking, we don't pay to advertise the show at all, and so you tweeting about the show and spreading the word of mouth is the only way that we get new listeners, and we sure do appreciate all the hard work y'all have been doing in that regard. So thank you all so, so much, and thank you for sticking with us while we had some special episodes mixed in there at the end of the year. Travis and I definitely needed a break as we sort of hung out with our new families and spent time with the rest of the family for the holidays, so thank you all for that. We are going to sort of put our nose to the grindstone now and really, really see this thing through, so stick with us. I hope you like the rest of the episode. The next one is going to go up on January 26th, so I will talk to you then. Bye. With that, the fourth green light above the door lights up, and the big heavy stone door opens. And again, it is just kind of pitch black through the door. You cannot see through it at all. And the wheel lowers down into the ground.
So I guess that answers what happened to the director, huh?
Yeah.
That was probably obvious, but I wanted to say it out loud so I didn't have people fucking tweeting at me like, hey, do you think
that was it?
Yes. Yeah, I get it. Yeah, I know. We're all adults here. I got you.
Cam comments from your bag. You can't hear him. He's like in a secret pocket dimension inside of a pocket of an actual bag. But he is he's yelling.
Okay, I'm gonna tie him to my shoulder like fucking Zaphod Beeblebrox just to get Griffin off my nuts.
All right, I like it. He says, boy, that was a real tough round. I sure appreciate y'all taking my sacrifice on for me. I guess I could have lost an eye, but it's like one of like four things I still have. And if I'm going to make it out of here, I really, I'm going to need all the meat I've got. So
you're going to have to teach Merle how to use an axe.
I might know a thing or two, he says. Actually, he sees you, Magnus, and says, whoa, what the hell happened to you?
What do you mean?
You're gray. You're all old. You're an old man now.
This is how I looked before.
Oh, I guess I just wasn't paying attention.
Yeah.
Damn. Let me preemptively interrupt all the tweets that I will be sending. 42 is not old. Okay, go on.
Griffin?
Yeah.
Before we move on, I want to make the Thieves Can't sign for room trap confirm.
Yeah, it confirms. This thing pushes into your hand and confirms.
Cool.
Taco and Merle, make a perception check.
Double fours. We didn't see shit.
All right. Then nothing happens. Okay. You moving on?
Yeah.
Yep.
Yep.
On we go.
You step forward, and as you're walking towards the door, you hear the elves. You hear the male elf say, ooh, that was a pretty tough round. We lost a lot of years and a good eye. But this next challenge, it's going to be a breeze, I promise. And as you walk through that pitch black door, you step into a new... another like huge circular chamber about the same dimensions as the one you just left. Only this one you also know, because there is a single pedestal in the middle of it, with two buttons on it and a screen sort of wrapped around the outside of it, with sort of digitized like cartoon versions of your faces on it. And you hear that male elf say, I mean, it's going to be a breeze if you make the right decision here. It's time for another round of Trust or Forsake. You know the deal. Step up to the plate, and you'll be matched up against an opponent. And then you pick the button that seems right for you.
I cast Mage Hand and okay. Smack Forsake.
It doesn't activate because the buttons aren't lit up and going yet. Okay. And you hear the female elf say, oh, just a minute, sweetheart. We haven't begun the game yet. We have to see who's going to be our player this time.
Can I ask you elves a question?
Sure, shoot. We can't promise that we'll answer.
Fair. Is this... So what we're looking at is like a loop of like spin the wheel, choose or forsake or whatever, fight some monsters, spin a wheel, forsake, blah, 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 right? That's mm-hmm. the loop?
Yeah.
And that's good for you? That doesn't get tiresome?
No, we've programmed a lot of variety into Wonderland. Loop isn't the right word either. Loop intimates that there's no finish line. There is a finish line, and your prize is waiting at the end of it.
How many rotations do we have to go through?
It's subjective. How many roads must a man walk down before you can call him a man?
Six.
How many roads?
Six. I think it's six.
Six, roughly six. It's
four.
Is it four? Well, average, five.
In order for you to earn your prize here in Wonderland, you have to do exactly that. You have to earn it. And once you've earned it, there it'll be.
How many of you, how many prizes have you passed out this year?
This year alone, I mean, we're only about halfway through the year. It's about midsummer, but probably a good 30 prizes or so.
Wow. Bullshit.
I don't believe you.
Lying, lychee.
You can roll insight if you want to see.
I'm going to roll insight. It's a 19.
19.
Plus... Yeah, that wasn't entirely accurate.
Plus 4, by the way, so yeah. 23.
Yeah, it's a fucking... They are not telling the truth.
How many people have died?
Oh, more than 30.
Give me a percentage.
I don't want to dishearten you is the problem, because you guys are doing so good.
Cast Zone. Oh, yeah.
They are nowhere yeah. near you. You cannot see them. They are not in your vicinity.
I can't see them anyway. I have no depth perception.
Cast it on me and then ask me what percentage of people have died. That way we'll get the answers.
The screen that like wraps around the pedestal in front of you starts to spin, and the person who is going to play this round of Trust or Forsake is Taco. You step up to the plate, Taco, and as you do, Cam from your shoulder says, you know you have to pick Forsake, right? Like, that's yeah. just, that's basic sort of
yeah.
the game here. If you
know, I appreciate the heads up, but yeah, I'm going to... Wait, go ahead and choose Forsake.
But that will end up fucking over the other people.
Yeah.
Or maybe they just want us to think that.
Oh, no. I don't give a shit.
But I don't want to fuck over the other people.
Then maybe next time you should get chosen as the player.
But think about it this way. Hold on. Think about it this way. Stay in posse, right?
For sure, yeah.
Stay in posse. We fought the last battle and did relatively fine.
Except I mean, Taco's almost dead.
Yeah, I'm almost dead. And
well,
it's
an
all
air
podcast.
Conditioner fell on him.
Cam chimes in and he's like, Magnus, Taco's right. He's on death's door. He can't fight another fight like the fight he just fought, or else he's a dead man. So you pick Forsake and we're on easy street.
This goes against everything I believe.
Well, luckily it's not your decision. Forsake.
All right. You hit Forsake. And the far wall across from you shows you chose Forsake, and they chose Trust.
Hell yeah!
Which means you and a little bit of confetti falls from the ceiling when that happens.
Short episode this week, kids.
Remind me, Griffin, what would have happened if we had both hit Trust?
So there's four outcomes to this game, and I realized listening back when I was editing it, you guys didn't quite understand the rules. There's four outcomes, okay? If you choose Forsake and they pick Trust, that's the best outcome for you. That means you don't have to do this killer challenge at all. If you both, the next outcome is both pick Trust, that means you play it at its like standard difficulty. If you both pick Forsake, that's the third worst outcome, I guess. And that means you both face a slightly harder version And if you pick Forsake and they pick Trust, they don't have to do the challenge, and you have to do like the really, really difficult version.
Oh, no,
which is what
you mean
if
we
time.
Pick Trust and they pick Forsake.
Right. If you if you get Forsaken, then you get fucked. But you did the Forsaking this time, which is good. Kind of.
I mean, not morally.
And Cam is like celebrating. He's like, yes, nice. You don't realize how brutal those challenges are. You're gonna.
Yeah, you're right. I don't. I got an air conditioner dropped on me, homie.
Yeah, that's a fair. Okay, you Taco, you understand how difficult it is. Yeah. And with that, the display that showed the results disappears, and a large black door appears in front of you that you just cannot see through. Another pitch black door.
Onward, I guess.
Yeah, here we go.
All right, you step forward into the next chamber. And as you enter the doorway, you step foot onto a 5-foot square of white light. And the word start is on this square. And as soon as you step onto it, the door is just gone behind you. And you hear a loud click as a blue square, the same size, illuminates right in front of you. And then another, and then a green square that has some sort of word written on it. And then this pattern continues with all these multicolored squares just sort of appearing, forming a winding path around you. And
it's Candyland.
You're standing in a board game. And as you look down, you realize that this platform is slightly elevated in the air, and the floor is covered in a bubbling green liquid. And from above you, you realize that the ceiling is just clouded with this swarm of bats that are all squealing. And some of the bats start to fly down in your direction, but then everything sort of freezes, and you hear one of the elves say, oh, dear, this shouldn't have manifested this way. You won the last round. Oh, pardon our mess. Suddenly you see a cloud of that black smog that sort of you emit every time you have complained in this environment. It quickly sort of lowers from the ceiling like a curtain, and the board game is gone. This room has been sort of re-outfitted. And instead of standing on the start square of a board game, you're standing behind podiums. And you have these bright lights in your face, and you can hear coming in the direction of these lights that are kind of blinding you a bit. You hear thunderous applause from a large studio audience. And as you look around, you realize you're standing on the sort of garishly decorated set of a game show. And you hear one of the elves say, live from the inescapable depths of Wonderland, it's time for another round of Heart Attack, the heroic dating show. And here's your hosts, Lydia and Edward. And you see those two elves appear in front of you, and they're holding those weird, small, skinny microphones as they host you in a dating show called Heart Attack. And there's a lot of applause, and there's a lot of voguing from these two. And the audience is just fucking eating it up. And they're wearing different outfits now. They're wearing crimson and silver and gold pantsuits. And they look fucking excellent. And they have big sunglasses on.
I don't know, Griffin. With them showing off like this, I'm just afraid that they're not here for the right reasons.
And the female elf who you now know, God, I'm so glad I can say their names now and not say male elf and female elf like I'm some sort of scientist. Elf scientist.
You could have just said felf and melf.
No, those have other meanings in the fantasy world, and they're extremely lewd. Lydia says, welcome to Heart Attack. Are you three brave heroes ready for your only chance at love?
Pass.
That's not an option, unfortunately. You don't have to play the deadly round, but we're still going to have a little bit of fun. Doesn't that sound good?
Yeah, sure. Yeah.
I mean, I cannot stress enough how uninterested I am in this.
Okay.
Right, we're not going to have a good time with it, but like we're pretty much prisoners, I guess. By the way, you did just say inescapable. So, like, how are things going? Pretty bad, it seems.
A little bit of black smog comes out of your mouth, Taco, as you say that.
Fuck.
And it lifts up into the ceiling. Those elves have their back turned to you as you were saying that, and they're sort of like still sort of performing for the crowd. And you, all three of you, actually see this. The black smog, previously, whenever you've sort of expressed your suffering, just sort of raises up into the ceiling and disappears. This time, like a little portion of it, kind of jerks in like a 90-degree angle and like follows a different path as if it's being siphoned off by something, and it disappears, which did not happen before. Next to you, a screen, not like a TV screen, but like a sheet of fabric, raises up, and from behind it, a light illuminates, and you see a kind of like human or elf-shaped silhouette, but it is so clearly not the silhouette of a living person. You can actually tell it actually looks like a mannequin because it has these like segmented arms and it's moving basically like that fucking scene from Home Alone where Kevin's trying to convince the wet bandits that there's a big party happening in his house. So it's moving around like a mannequin or a marionette sort of being moved by puppet, and it's sort of waving at you all flirty, all flirty-like. Edward says, we're going to ask a series of questions to measure your compatibility with our hot contestant. Whoever charts with the highest lovability quotient will get a hot date out of it. Are you three ready?
Sure. Yeah.
Woo!
Yeah, let's do it.
The silhouette blows a kiss.
No, you know what? Fuck this.
What do you mean?
I don't want to play.
You have to play, or you can't move on.
Well, I mean, I'm going to stand here, but I'm not going to... I hate this.
As you're saying that, so much of that black smog is coming out of your face.
And I'm watching where it's going.
Yeah, it's getting peeled off a little bit. It's definitely... You're siphoning off like a bunch of this stuff. And actually, at this point, Lydia and Edward are looking at you. And as soon as they like turn around to look at you as you're complaining, that siphoning stops and you feel that force in your hand. And you feel a thieves cant symbol that means like the time isn't right. Like you would put this on a house that you thought was empty, but it's not yet. And so the marks are home. And so you would put this on there. And then you feel the symbol for confirm.
I make the shape of confirm. All right, fine. Let's play.
All right. Edward says, question one, we'll go ahead and read for our contestant because they're very shy. And they, this silhouette shrugs. Oh, well. Edward says, question one, Magnus, what is your ideal first date?
Oh gosh. Let's see. I would say I pick them up, round about sundown, and then we catch fireflies, and then I take them home, and we don't see each other again, because I'm really not interested in dating.
The studio audience, from behind these bright lights, you hear them go, ooh, and the silhouette is, like, fanning itself. Lydia says, playing hard to get, huh? It seems like our contestant is into that. Merle, same question. What's your ideal first date?
All right, I let her pick me up. I mentioned to her that I forgot my wallet at home. Even though we're, you know, like in the front yard.
The audience. The audience gets a good chuckle out of that, and they are fucking loving Merle.
I volunteer to drive her vehicle and tell her it's filthy. And so we go through the drive-through vehicle wash, and she pays for that too. And then I take her to have dinner with my family.
Wife and stuff?
She meets my ex-wife. It really kind of sucks. She's having a miserable time, and she's really mad. She can't wait to get out of there. I take her back to her house, and so I lean up against the door jamb and say, sure you don't want me to come in for a few minutes? And she slams the door in my face.
That's the ideal first date. Wait, hold on.
Yeah, big round of applause from the audience on that one. And Edward says, I love your honesty. Taco, another question. Say that you and our contestant are on a date, and one of your fans recognizes you on the street. How do you respond to that situation?
Well, you know, I really, my fans come first. So I would definitely sign whatever pose for fantasy pictures. Not fantasy pictures, but fantasy pictures, you know, because there's not cameras. I don't mean like fantastical pictures. I just mean like whatever passes for a camera in this reality.
I think it's drawing, isn't it?
Drawing. yeah, if they want to draw me like the French girls, that's fine. And, you know, I would just make sure that the fan got what they were looking for because they come first. I need everyone I can get at this point, honestly.
It's absolutely silent in the studio. And you see the silhouette cross its shadowy arms and kind of tap its foot from behind the sheet. And Edward says, kind of an airball there, kind of a brick. That's okay. We'll get him on the next round.
Great.
Magnus, same question. Say you and the contestant are on a date and one of your fans recognizes you on the street. How do you respond to that situation?
I have fans?
Well, one of your heroic fans, sure.
I guess, are they, what do they want? What does the fan want? They just recognize, they're just like, hey, Magnus.
Yeah, the question seemed pretty clear.
Well, but I mean, the interaction varies because if they just want like a wave and like, oh, hey, I keep going. If they want me to stop and like sign a chair or something, whittle them a small duck, that might be inconvenient based on my schedule. Do we have dinner reservations? Are we trying to get somewhere in a certain amount of time? There's a lot of parameters in every social interaction.
The audience is actually booing you now, Magnus.
Oh, okay. I guess what I mean to say is, since I was with my date first, they would take priority.
The audience is now whistling and clapping and laughing for you.
Cool.
They're overjoyed. And the silhouette is fanning itself again. The silhouette is feeling Magnus.
I want you guys to know I am both weirded out, but my competitive streak is kind of taking over, and now I sort of want to win.
Merle, new question. Why shouldn't the contestant choose your two competitors?
Well, because, I mean, look at Magnus. I mean, even though he's in his 40s, he's kept himself up. He's in magnificent shape. He would not be a gentle lover.
Whoa!
Don't go with him.
I regret this entire podcast.
Don't go with him.
This whole podcast has been a mistake up to because of this.
Taco is... He's too much into his work. Always chopping, always salt, always making sauces. And, you know, when he's not cooking, he's studying about cooking. So there wouldn't be any time left for you. Whereas I am so old and I only got one arm.
I don't have a lot going on right now.
I don't have a lot going on. I'll do nothing but, like, pay attention to you.
Taco, same question. Why shouldn't the contestant choose either of your competitors?
It's me. Hi, I'm Taco? You know, from TV?
There is such thunderous applause, and a chair actually comes fucking flying out of the audience and, like, slides across the set. The audience is losing their mind. The silhouette does not seem as impressed.
I cast Tasha's hideous laughter on the silhouette.
Fucking shit, okay. What's that do?
Creature of your choice, you can see within range, perceives everything as hilariously funny, and falls into fits of laughter if this spell affects it. Must succeed on a wisdom saving throw or fall prone, becoming incapacitated, and then it will stand up for the duration.
Fucking
a creature with an intelligence score of 4 or less isn't affected.
Okay. So I roll wisdom save?
Yeah, wisdom save.
That's a 9.
Nope.
Okay, so... Yeah, then this... Oh, this is going to get bad. This shape from behind the curtain falls out of its chair, and as it does, you see its head pop off, and it picks up its head and laughs at that, and now it's, like, doubled over laughing at that, and now this shape behind the curtain is just sort of... flailing around in laughter in, like, weird, like, inscrutable ways. And the audience sees this and is also laughing at this. And, gang, the scene's getting maybe a little bit spooky.
Magnus is suitably horrified.
and actually the lights have started to lower a little bit, and, the two elves turn to you, Magnus, and say, Magnus, what makes a good hero?
I cast True Seeing on Magnus.
What does that do?
He can see things as they actually are. For the duration, he has true sight. He sees secret doors hidden by magic and can see into the ethereal plane, all out to a range of 120 feet.
Okay. Magnus, you don't warn him then, right, Taco?
No, I can't. I can't take the risk.
All right, fucking Magnus. Suddenly and without explanation, your vision changes, and you can see the audience now through the lights, and it is just a bunch of these fairly intricately put together wooden marionettes. They are faceless, but otherwise they are detailed, complete with, like, fingers and joints on those fingers. And they are the ones sort of moving around and reacting to all of these scenes. You see...
As he's looking around, I say, you know what? Fuck all this. This fucking sucks. I'm done playing.
Okay, then you see, Taco, you see a black cloud come out of your mouth as you say this. Magnus, back to you. One other thing that you see is these two elves in their fancy jumpsuits, pantsuits rather, they don't look like elves, actually, with your current sight. They are both wearing black robes, and they you cannot really see their faces inside of this robe. You sort of see a faint red light coming from within their hoods, and they have, like, semi-skeletal arms and a body underneath. And you recognize that they are liches. And you also see, standing just sort of slightly in front of you, Magnus, you see that red robe. And it's the one that you've seen so many times now. The one that confronted you, after the big race in Pedals to the Metal, the one that, confronted you in the Cosmoscope in Lucas's lab. And he is standing there, and you see him sort of siphoning off that black cloud as Taco is sort of projecting it into the atmosphere. And the other two liches don't seem to see him. It seems like you are the only one that can see him with your true sight. And he looks over and realizes that he can see you and that you can see each other. And you just see this red robe put a single... skeletal finger to its non-existent lips.
MaximumFun.org.
Comedy and culture.
Artist owned.
Listener supported. Hey guys, this is Adam Conover. You may know me from my True TV show, Adam Ruins Everything. Well, guess what? Now we're doing a podcast version right here on Maximum Fun. What we do is we take all the interesting, fascinating experts that we talk to for just a couple minutes on the show, and we sit with them for an entire podcast, really going deep and getting into the fascinating details of their work. Find Adam Ruins Everything wherever you get your podcasts or at MaximumFun.org.
Hi, this is Griffin McElroy.
Hi, this is Rachel McElroy.
And we're the hosts of Rose Buddies. It's a podcast about the Bachelor family of products.
We watch The Bachelor, The Bachelorette, and Bachelor in Paradise.
Yes, it is garbage television, but we're the king and queen of this garbage pile. We're the raccoons in charge around here.
So join us on Tuesdays.
Because the TV show's on Mondays. And basically we'll recap what we saw, and we'll just sort of scoop the garbage around us and make a little fort out of it.
No viewing required.
But it's a good TV show. What are you doing?